It was obvious to us, all of us in France, that the war with Germany would break out any time.
In World War II, we felt we had to stop Hitler.
We knew the war that was coming. They didn't have to tell us.
We knew something was going to happen, but we didn't know when.
We knew we were going into France somewhere.
I knew something was popping because there was an enormous amount of glider planes up there.
And there was this huge roar. And I peeked through the window and I saw thousands of planes.
And at the briefing then, we noticed that the airplanes had been painted and we were told it was D-Day.
And at that point, I knew that we were in for something big.
They were training us for the invasion of Normandy at that time.
Well, this was it. I mean, we're now on the ship. We've been briefed. They had us in a briefing area with guards walking around to shoot us if we tried to get out, because we now knew where we were going.
The brass knew what the beaches were going to be like with all of the preparation that the Germans had been making over the years.
The invasion was the beginning of the end for Germany.
One of the most extreme experiences a human being can go through is being a combat infantryman. And nowhere was combat more extreme than here at Omaha Beach in the early morning hours of June 6, 1944. Today, many years later, the sound of the ocean waves coming ashore brings with it a tranquil feeling. The peacefulness of the early morning here on the west coast of France is exhilarating and yet haunting. In June of 1944, Allied troops heading for the Normandy coastline mounted the largest amphibious attack ever recorded in history. After months of planning, preparation, and intense training, D-Day had finally arrived. H hour was 06:30.
I don't think we slept much the night before.
At midnight, we had our last breakfast.
But we got something in our stomachs and went to our briefing.
The night before, when we got the final word, there was a few men made visits to the chaplain, myself included.
They assembled the troops about midnight when we got the official notice that we were going to land, and they did. They had a prayer service.
Men were sort of pulled within themselves, thinking about what could happen.
We stood there for a long time without much being said. We was thinking about what might happen.
It was all brand new. We had no really idea what it was going to be like when we hit the beach. Yes, I knew I was going to be the first ones on the beach. I mean, we'd went through all that. We knew why we was there. We was there to protect the infantry.
I don't know that we knew what was really going to happen. We knew we had a job to do.
You just didn't know what was going to happen till it came. It was so quick, because we thought we was going to land without any trouble at all. Some of the troops, this was their first time into combat, and they didn't have the slightest idea of what it was going to be like.
We had no idea what we were getting into, and a serious, doubtful outcome of the thing.
At midnight, bombers would come over and bomb the beach, and there was to be nothing living on the beach. Nothing living.
Went across the channel, it was very dark, but we could hear the bombing.
Got all of our gear ready, and then it's about time to load.
The boat crew was summoned to get into landing craft at 1 o'clock.
And our responsibility was to load the boat according to the priorities of the supplies that were going to be needed.
We were fully loaded with the 29th Infantry and their accompanying tanks, Sherman tanks.
He wanted all fresh troops, you know, gung-ho, and that's how we were. We went in there and nothing could hit us, you know, that's what, how we felt.
I don't know if any of them really had any sense of reality as to what was going on and what could happen. It's a situation where you're there, you're doing it, and at that age, you're invincible as a young fellow.
I was just 19 and 40 days. I had a birthday, and then 40 days later, we hit the beach.
I think that's why they had such young guys go in. You know, an 18-year-old don't think near as much about life as a 40-year-old man does.
We're supposed to go into a beach sector called Dog Red.
We were scheduled to land on Easy Red.
We were slated to land on Omaha Dog Red.
I went in, I was to land at Dog White.
The weather at the time had been terrible. But I don't know how Eisenhower made that decision to go with it.
This is it, we're going in. Weather or not weather. If it turns to hell, we're going in.
Can you imagine the pressure on that man to make that decision?
They had warned us that this was it.
Our only problem was we didn't realize how much firepower the Germans had on the coast.
An Land gehende Truppen und Panzer werden sofort mit Pack, MG und leichten Geschützen bekämpft.
Somebody had mentioned the 352nd. This is a German division that was camped right on the top of Omaha Beach.
But the only surprise we had is one German division, and we couldn't have known this, was ordered on maneuvers at Omaha Beach on D-Day.
Hitler, he would not allow on D-Day. He would not allow that Panzer division, which was on maneuvers just behind the beach, to move up on the beach and try to push us back in the water, which they could have done.
But once we loaded on the ships, it was wait, 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 because you had to sit there on these ships and wait for your landing sequence, your wave, what wave you were in.
We were on the first wave. So I was in landing barge 13. Crawford says, "My God," he says, "you'll never live through it." And I says, "No, 13 is my lucky number."
The Invasion LST has 6 davits. That means you carry 6 Higgin boats. You're in the first wave of every invasion. You hit the beach first because you want to get those guys in fast as you can and as many as you can.
We dispatched 6 LCVPs, and each LCVP had about 36 men aboard, infantrymen.
We got in the boats, and then they lowered us into the water. The first wave was lowered into the water right in their boats.
Fortunately, they had us just load over the railing into the boats and then lowered them for their divots down into the ocean.
On the troop ship, which was several miles out, away from the beach, We boarded a smaller landing craft to approach the beach.
Some of the help was throwing a rope ladder over the side of the ship.
You had your full pack on with your rifle, the whole works, and you swung over the top, and you came right down those cargo nets, right down into the Higgins boat. And as soon as you got your load, they took you in.
We went over the side on these nets, and there was quite a bit of turbulence in the water, and these landing crafts are bouncing up and down, and you had to be very careful about the way you release yourself from the nets and get into the boat.
In rough weather, those Higgins boats bounced up and down. The guys had to go down on the cargo nets.
And I remember going down the rope ladders inside the ship, and we had so much equipment, we probably dropped a little bit here and there.
We came down the ropes, we all got in there, and we looked at each other. What is this? It's war, I guess. Everything was going crazy.
A lot of them were afraid to climb over the side of that ship and then climb down, and I'll never forget they lost the helmets, they lost their rifles.
Some of them were not that sure-footed. You know, carrying about 60 pounds on your back.
What you're doing, your hands go one way and your feet goes the other way. And
that's an interesting thing, watching those guys go over. It's almost acrobatic. When the boat comes up, the LCVP, that they step off onto it, or when it goes all the way down, they scurry down.
And just as I left loose of the rope, the LCT went down, so I dropped about 5 feet.
And so we got in our boats, we got down, and
cast off from the ship.
The clouds had broken up enough so we could see through some holes and what was below. And what was below us was unbelievable. It was just hundreds and thousands of boats of all size headed for the same direction, the Normandy beaches. And it was a sight I'll never forget.
That time we could see at daybreak what a gigantic force it was. There were ships in all directions.
We looked down and I can never forget it because I looked down and the channel was nothing but ships and boats from one side to the other. They just, you couldn't count them. There was thousands of them down there.
You could look for one, just make it look like that, and there was nothing but boats and ships, and I mean, just solid, the whole, as far as you could see anyway.
Time we got to the beachhead area, it was light. By then we could see, and they had this vast panorama of ships and planes and people. It's mind-boggling. You know, in my wildest imagination, I couldn't picture something like this.
There were a number of LCVPs. The LCIs could not go in yet, or the LSTs. The attack troops had to go in on LCVPs.
When the six VPs, as we call them, are fully loaded, they take off and they will circle. They get into a little group here, and you see these pods of LCVPs circling, and they're waiting for a beachmaster. This is usually a Navy man who is in liaison with the Army.
My position was to lead the third wave, consisting of 15 boats, and we went like a V in a line of geese that would be flying.
It was a lead boat that went in that led the flotilla of landing craft in towards the beach.
Well, they brought those ships in like that because the waves were, oh man, they were just taking those Higgins boats and they were like a cork in the water.
It was so rough. We were just bouncing against the boat, everything, just bouncing.
The weather was miserable. High wind, high waves, cold, rain, low clouds.
Now, it was very rough that day. The waves were pretty big, and we were jammed in this landing craft. They had given each of us two vomit bags because if you were going to be sick, there was no place to go except the neck of the man in front of you because you were jammed there against each other. And so most of the people, I think, used both of their bags before we got ashore.
The bottom of the boat was so full of vomit, you could hardly stand up.
My gunner was deathly seasick. He was green. He was throwing up. He was throwing up when he couldn't throw up. And my worry was, I am no good if I don't have a gunner.
I felt so sorry for the troops, the soldiers. Us sailors, we had our sea legs, as we call it, and it didn't bother us, but these guys were so sick.
We didn't care whether we got hit, killed, or whatever. We were so miserable.
I think most all of them were probably so seasick, they were just wanting to get off of the boat.
I remember just the circling out there, and the destroyers was out there since daylight, shooting over the top of our head. We could hear the shells going in.
It sounded like a freight train.
After we got in so far, the Navy went to firing, and I mean they blew that hill all to thunder, hell box. And it didn't look like it could be a person alive there.
On the way in, we seen the bombardment. Heavy bombardment from the battleship.
I do remember right next to us was the USS Texas. It was so loud. booming with their big guns.
I never forget, I was standing there when one went over and I could see that 16-inch shell or whatever size it was just going towards the beach, and my helmet just rattled. I shook it off my head.
I'm standing here in the dog green sector of Omaha Beach. To my right was Charlie Sector. To my left or to the east were Landing Beach sectors, Dog White, Dog Red, Easy Green, Easy Red, Fox Green, and Fox Red. Landing under the command of the 1st American Army Division, the 741st and 743rd Amphibious Tank Battalions were the first American elements to come ashore on D-Day. Here on Dog Green at exactly 0636, the first wave of Higgins boats carrying Able Company of the 116th Regiment, 29th Division landed. Charlie Company of the 2nd Ranger Battalion and Baker Company of the 116th Regiment followed close behind. As the order was given, Navy coxswains lowered the ramp doors along the boat line, and the seasick men jumped off in water, anywhere from waist deep to higher than a man's head. What happened next was like an opening scene from the movie Saving Private Ryan.
Die Massen der anglo-amerikanischen Invasionsflotte auf. Abwehr aus allen Rohren.
When they saw us turn toward the beach, they know we're coming.
When they spotted us, things broke loose, and it broke loose good.
As we approached the beach in the landing craft, the Germans fired on any approach to the beach.
When we started passing the Navy ships and they were firing, while we know we were getting close.
As we're coming in, you could see the artillery of the Germans going up and down the beach.
There was a lot of action when we got near the beach.
We started in, I was looking out that slot in that door, and I thought, oh my God, what are we getting into here? You know, because all we've been doing is landing on slaps and sands in England. It was nothing like this.
We're going in, and it's beginning to get light, and it doesn't look too good.
When you go to the movies and see this sort of thing, you see the whole picture. But when we went in on that boat, we seen how much on each side. We didn't see the picture like you see it in the movies. All we seen is just right straight ahead what you had to do.
We could see shrapnel and bullets hitting the water and boats being hit.
Guys were trying to duck down below the gunwales.
Oh, they were. You knew what they were shooting at you long before the door went down.
I saw machine gun fire. You could look like rain out in front of the boat, and I didn't really think much of it until it hit the ramp in front of me. Then I thought something of it.
I saw a direct hit by another one of these landing craft, and it popped that thing right out of the water.
The boat blew completely out of the water, and all I seen was kids, their arms are flying and bodies flying all over.
I remember we talked about it, the difficulty of getting off the landing craft.
We got pretty close in and we were making the last run. He said they were headed right in.
The lieutenant was urging the coxswain to get us in there. We're running behind time. Coxswain says, I'll go in when I get a green light. When he did get the signal, it was a tense moment. We could feel that LCVP, the power surge. Everybody said, this is it.
Well, at 6:30, just after the tanks had landed on the beach, there arrived the landing LCVPs.
When we got in close enough, they dropped the ramp. The boat stopped, and they lowered, dropped the ramp, the door, and bail out. He pulled the gate and said to us, go.
We got about 100 yards from the beach, and the front dropped down, and the man in charge of the landing craft said, this is as far as I go, off you go.
When that landing craft stops, that's it. The order is given by the coxswain to lower the ramp is dropped down and out.
And he says, everybody off. And naturally, we had to get off.
When that ramp went down, so did our numbers go.
And when we went off, I never will forget, I thought I was going to drown.
They wore an inflatable life jacket, and they wore it underneath their packet in the back. And so they'd squeeze the CO2 cartridges, and they'd float bottom up and drown.
We rolled off that landing craft into the water, and we went about 20 feet, and we sunk.
A lot of them didn't get out of the water. I remember laying there on the beach looking back and seeing guys in the water.
I walked on my tip of my toes. And then you had to hold your rifle above your head to keep your rifle dry. A lot of the fellows drowned right there and getting going to shore. But you had 65-pound full-field packs on your back.
Many of them that went in first, they never had a chance. They were sitting up high shooting right down on them with good-sized guns, and they hit those landing craft right in the front, you know, right in the gates and drop, and boom.
When I got up to the water's edge, and I heard all the machine guns and 88 shooting at you, plus rockets and other things, something went wrong. Something went wrong.
There was at least two machine guns setting up way up high. They were firing at us.
The Germans were shooting at us. And we just kept running forward to get on the beach.
Well, the Germans had, in one particular place, they had a dual 50 caliber machine gun at the top of this hill. And that probably was responsible for a lot of casualties.
They had us pinned down. I mean, we couldn't do anything.
You stayed real low. And in fact, when we got onto the beach, we crawled. You never stood up.
Those beaches were zeroed in, and you can imagine that there were hundreds of thousands of bullets from the German machine guns, and they're from their rifles, the automatic weapons.
These two companies, the A Company and the B Company, landed just in front of the Vierville Draw. And it was a very bad place because the Vierville Draw was well equipped with a machine gun, German machine gun.
They had machine guns on those beaches. And they was crossfire, you know, they'd shoot, they was what they call crossfire like that. And you couldn't get, it was almost impossible for those Rangers and those infantry to get on the beach. They just couldn't make it. They'd mow them down.
And they just went from one side to the other with those machine guns. And they put you down. It was unreal. How we ever made it, I don't know. With the grace of God, that's all I can say.
And here we are in the middle of an invasion, and you don't realize it. I mean, until you see sorry.
And by the time I got to the beach, the infantry had started coming in then. And at least half of them were still laying in the water. They didn't make it.
There were so many men in the water that the ramp man had to act as a telegraph person and tell the coxswain which way to turn the boat not to run over the dead that were floating in the water.
I do remember a lot of bodies and a lot of them never got out of their landing boats.
After the first couple of waves, the water was just full of people. It was full of soldiers and sailors. You know, their landing barges were exploded.
The beach was there's bodies. It was bad. In fact, where the tide comes in, they just weren't piled up.
We knew that there was trouble on the beach before we went in. We knew everything was backed up. What was supposed to happen on the beach wasn't happening.
Things have not gone as they were scripted, and the infantry is still here on the beach, and they're being shot up, and there's all these wounded and dead along with them.
Everything it was in such a chaos that nobody really knew what was going on.
And it was really confusing to try and remember what you had to do at a certain time and where.
And nobody knew where we were because we were landed on the wrong spot. We I come in on easy green, and that didn't mean nothing, but I could see the Rangers, and we were too far to the left.
But really, it was going so fast, and things were happening so fast, that you didn't have time to ponder a bit. You just did it.
You know, we were completely detached from all the members of our outfit. Most of the non-commissioned officers and some of the officers had disappeared where, I don't know, some got killed.
And we knew that the initial waves were still on the beach, and there was a lot of equipment destruction.
There was debris all over the beach, blown out tanks, trucks, you name it, it was laying there on the beach.
You know where you're supposed to go, and then when you land and you're not where you're supposed to be, it's mass confusion then. And officers were being knocked out, and non-coms were being killed or wounded, and a lot of the guys were on their own.
Looking around and the situation, it was impossible to really describe the chaos, the debris, the wrecked equipment, and the wounded and the dead.
At 08:30, all landing sets ceased on Omaha Beach. Men were close to despair. It seemed Rommel's fixed defenses had stopped the Americans cold. To the German 352nd Infantry Division, it appeared as though the Americans were initiating a withdrawal. Men and vehicles, almost none of them operating, were jammed up on the beach. Not more than a few platoons of men had made it up the bluff. Here on Easy Red, like the 116th, the 16th Regiment of the 1st Division landed in a state of confusion under intense German machine gun, rifle, mortar, and artillery fire from both flanks and up front. Beached obstacles were not cleared, and most officers who were the first men off the boats were either wounded or killed before they could even take one step on the beach. Many soldiers on D-Day soon knew the largest of the landing beach sectors, codenamed Easy Red, as Bloody Red.
There's this Omaha, what they called Easy Red, but which later they called Bloody Red. The worst beach of all of the five beaches.
The first thing I saw was a group of soldiers lying around in a circle dead.
Now the first four waves of the 1st Infantry Division, when they went in to make the invasion, they were surprised. Boy, they were shot up, you'd never believe, with machine guns. That's all you heard and heard.
They took a direct hit. I'm sure not one got off that barge. It just blew them all to pieces. That was my first look at total destruction. And the bodies were just floating all over and continuous. It just kept getting worse.
And the fellow that was in the hole with me, he kind of stuck his head up to see what was going on, and a shell blew right alongside the hole and knocked his head right off his shoulders. So I was in there all night long with that fellow with all that blood all over the place. At that moment, I thought the human life wasn't worth 2 cents, seeing so much of that, you know.
We found him. He didn't make it. The whole chest was blowing out.
Our medics were forced to go out in the water and rescue all the wounded infantry that was coming in. That was their job.
I came onto a photo there when I was going through the minefield myself. And I had a leg blown off, and I cut the other one, and the other one I had to cut off with a pair of scissors.
I had all the blood plasma, I think, for the 3rd Battalion on my back when I landed. There were so many people wounded so badly, and they needed to get blood into them.
I'll never forget the water was really rough that day, and the salt water would come in, and we weren't medics, and we weren't allowed to touch them. We couldn't do nothing for them. And they would be screaming and hollering when that salt water hit their open wounds. And it was a terrible thing for me to see.
You automatically have an impulse. The guy says, help me, help me. And a lot of them were laying on the edge of the water. And you knew when a wave came in, it was going to take them back out.
We had increasing casualties and man that should have been taken off the beach, badly wounded, but they never made it.
I'm sure that there's a lot of them could have been helped had there been facilities there, but there just were no facilities.
That's the worst thing is somebody asking for help and you just can't do it.
I know there was guys screaming and hollering and yelling, you know, and they wounded, couldn't get any help, speak of.
When I was wounded, there was only three of us left in the entire company of 250 men. Three of us left.
You were scared to death. You didn't know what had happened the next minute. After you see someone die, you can't help but think, I wish I was gone. I wish I was somewhere else.
What the hell am I doing here? Is what I was thinking about. What is going on? It's something that you cannot visualize. Nobody can visualize it unless you've seen it.
Before we could get a medic there, he had died. And I think Lieutenant Peterson was one of the nicest young guys you'd ever meet in your life. That was a shock to us to see one of our fellow men die that quick, you know. That's when you really knew that you was in a war.
There was a lot of casualties. Some things that would
be hard to talk about.
All that was there when we went in was they were all dead. Just laying there in pieces, some of them.
And they were all ages, 18 to 40. It was sad.
So after a little while, the tank commander again told me I had to move out, and I called back and said, I can't. He said, why? I said, I'll run over soldiers. I said, they were just laying everywhere. And he said, well, we have to move. And I had to give that an awful thought. That's the worst thing in the world your man has to do. But I started out and I decided if I got to run over anybody, I'm going to go for the lakes. And that's what I did. And I made sure that I would be off of him before I turned, because them old tracks would just tear him up. But I run over quite a few soldiers. There was no way to get away from it.
They were ready to give up on Omaha Beach, and they were hoping to not to land any more men, and they were going to take it around. I think Omar Bradley was the one that was going to make the decision.
I never realized that we was that close to being pushed off the beach.
We got word out there that it's possibly that we weren't going to make it. We're going to have to pull the troops off that Omaha.
We didn't know it at the time, but Omar Bradley was thinking about evacuating the beach, getting the soldiers back into the boats and back, you know, off of the beach.
In the quarter of an hour after the landing, there were casualties, dead or wounded.
Fellas on Omaha Beach, we could see them from where we were going, you know, when we were making the trips back and forth. They were taking one hell of a beating down there. And battle wagons and the cruisers were fighting like hell, hitting that shore and hitting that beach. They kept throwing those men in and they were taking a beating. Even the Higgins boats were taking a beating, because not only were they getting hit by fire from the shore, they were getting hit with the stuff that the Germans had set up in the water, you know, mines and so on and so forth.
We didn't know, as the sailors, we didn't know the fullest extent of the brutality, of the casualties until later. We knew it was bad because of all the messages that were being sent back and forth. We need troops.
The Germans had a real advantage over us. They had concealment in the vegetation and on the higher ground above the beach. They had a great advantage over us, where we were simply put out on the open sand. There was no concealment. We were in full view of the German gunners.
On the beach, and the beach was as large as 300 meters, and the men had to walk first in the 50 meters of water and then 300 meters of sand and under the fire of the machine gun.
And these gun emplacements on top of that hill is just, well, our troops were just sitting ducks.
And I got the broadcast from London, the BBC, and they were announcing that the invasion had started. There was very few casualties on the BBC, very few casualties. Look around, I seen young boys dead all over the place, laying. Some of them are out in the water.
Pretty hard to tell you really how bad it really was.
I've seen coxswains coming back crying.
The beach was pretty loaded with dead guys. And the water was just red from blood.
The beaches were red. I mean, you couldn't help but see that as you walked down along the beach. It was red with blood, and the fallen guys were there, and they were moaning and what have you. So you couldn't help but walk over them as we were doing our work. And so it's a fate that you don't want to even talk about.
I think about those that died. I was there among them, and why I lived and they didn't, I just don't understand.
I guess you don't realize anything until after you look around and see what's going on around you, and there's nothing you can do.
That was a terrible experience for young people.
Really, the American public couldn't possibly stomach what really happened.
The wounded and the dead was an awesome sight.
Sad. Just real sad.
I come away with some sad memories of guys that I lost. They were great people.
I don't cry. They were a great bunch of guys. They were real soldiers.
On Omaha Beach, on the 6th June, about 3,800 Americans were casualties. That's to say, killed in action, wounded in action, and missing in action.
The American people, as a whole, really do not know what war is like. War, I'm going to use the word hell. We went through hell.
Sometimes in your older years, you look back at things that happened to you and happened to other people, and you begin to realize how lucky you were that it wasn't your time.
The real heroes, in my opinion, it's not people like myself that's here. It's the people that's buried over there. They're the heroes.
The site here at the 172-acre American Cemetery in Coville, France is truly breathtaking. Buried among the many rows of white markers are 9,386 American military dead, most of who gave their lives during the landings and ensuing operations of World War II. The immaculate landscape seen here today sharply contrasts the brutal battle which waged on Omaha Beach just a few hundred yards away. Overlooking Fox Green and Easy Red sectors of Omaha Beach, the American Cemetery once again reminds us of the ultimate price for freedom. In the words of Ernie Pyle, I want you to know and to appreciate and to forever be humbly grateful to those both dead and alive who did it for you.
I helped dig the first cemetery on Omaha Beach with a tractor. And we dug the width of the tractor.
And they dug a trench down about 4 feet into the beach sand. And they just put bodies in bags, just with their dog tags on the bag, and then they covered them up.
And they were piled that day in the beach like cordwood. Stacked up like cordwood at the end of the day.
We buried a lot of them on the beach. When we buried them, those dog tags, you took one dog tag and put in a bag. You had a peg, it looked like a tent peg, that you put that on that and put it at the head of where you laid the guy out. I guess somebody had to do it, and we were there, and so it wasn't a very good detail.
I feel like this is my country, mine, my own country. I helped save it, and with my buddies, and I saw them go.
Well, I think that in large part, the freedoms and liberty we have today is due primarily to veterans like myself who gave their all, didn't hesitate.
We did it for America. Because if we didn't do it, they would have been in your doorstep.
Somebody has made a sacrifice for them to be able to enjoy their freedoms, and that they should appreciate it.
Freedom is not free.
Nothing is free. Nothing is free. You've got to fight for it, and you can't get it for nothing.
We all take it for granted, but the freedom that we have didn't come by easy.
I'm not sure that people, really know what freedom is until they've been deprived of it, I guess.
Liberty is everything. Without liberty, nothing else is possible.
I think my message is that you just have to stand up for those things that you believe in. Being free is a very valuable commodity, and just don't let anyone take your freedoms away from you.
I think the kids today should thank their parents, their grandparents, and the good Lord to have the freedom that they have.
We volunteered to go in, and we actually fought for this country because we loved this country and still do.
I never heard anybody really regret the fact that they were drafted and had to do the job.
Generally speaking, in this country, we have freedoms that most people in the world don't know what it's like at all.
Be a true American. Be a true American. We got a great country. Keep it that way.
What I did was for freedom for our country. I look forward to living in this country till I die as a free man.
We have a privilege to live and do things in a free country.
We fought to protect the American flag and to protect our country.
I have got probably as much respect for the flag as any man alive. I fly my flag every day of the year, and I'm proud of that flag.
As far as I'm concerned, the heroes of the invasion of Normandy are still there.
The heroes were those people that didn't come back.
My heroes are dead. My friends, they are the heroes. I survived.
There's a lot of them there laying over there that died over there. They were the heroes.
Their time was up and they died for the country. And to me, I wasn't a hero. They were. The ones that are still back there.
The heroes are laying over there in France. I'm just one of the lucky ones that got home. All I did was I did what I was told to do.
When you remember your friends that's buried there, you know who the real heroes were. And the rest of us that were lucky enough to come home were just doing a job that was necessary.
I think about everybody. We was doing a job that had to be done. I don't think it was a guy in my outfit that was looking for glory.
I didn't see any cowards on that day. People who were told to do a job, they did it.
Everybody was scared, but it was something we had to do, and we knew we had to do it.
We're in a war, and we were going to be in it until it was settled. And the sooner we could get it settled, the sooner we would get home.
We didn't start this. And I'm getting paid $21 a month to do it. So I did it.
Nobody likes war. I don't like war. I don't think anybody likes war. But it's something we have to do.
So many of the men in World War II was aware of what Hitler was doing.
If he'd had another 6 months, he might have turned the tide of the war. He had jet planes that we didn't have. If he had another 6 months to develop his Air Force with jet planes, and if he had somehow worked out the formula for the atom bomb, given another 6 or 12 months, he might have done that. So that's why D-Day was so critical and why it's being so celebrated.
I really believe that had we not done what we did, that it wouldn't have been too long before Hitler and the Nazis and whatever allies they had would have found a way to strike us here at home.
But all the other countries the Germans were taking over, I mean, we realize the goal was to conquer the world, evidently.
We only had one thought, and that was to get the Germans out and go home.
I'm glad I was there because now I can think back, I at least deserved to live in this country.
How I survived or how we survived, it's a miracle.
To this day, I think it was a privilege. Not many 18-year-olds get a chance to be part of one of the greatest battles of the 20th century.
As evening sets in here on Omaha Beach, one cannot forget the unselfish sacrifice of American men and women around the world who allow us to continue living in freedom. Here on the western coast of France, we must continue to remember what happened nearly 60 years ago. Many of the liberties and freedoms we enjoy today in America and around the world are a direct result of the blood that was shed on French soil. The thousands of men who died during the D-Day landings and throughout the ensuing operations in Europe were not in vain. It is now up to each of us to live our lives the best that we can and to bring honor and respect to those veterans who survived D-Day and those who never returned home from Normandy, lest they be forgotten.
June the 6th, I picked up the Naples paper. There wasn't a single thing in there. I turned to my wife and I said, how could they forget? So we called the editor and he couldn't explain it. He said, I guess we must have missed this one. And it has a couple hundred thousand circulation.
But I know that it's something I'll never forget. It's burned right into my memory.
But looking back 50, 60 years ago to the Omaha and to the Utah Beach or the Normandy campaign, it's gone. We achieved a remarkable thing there.
It was an exciting time.
But it was certainly an effort, a wonderful effort by everyone involved. It's something to be proud of.
Every day when I live here, every day sometimes I think of what happened 59 years ago.
It was a very exciting time, and a time you never forget in your life when you go through something like that.
Naturally, the Normandy campaign was immensely successful.
The miserable things and high points of the misery is stuff that you'll live with to the end.
Everybody, I guess, is a hero.